want to thank you all for coming tonight to the 5th UC Santa Cruz Live Silicon Valley event. I'm Jessica Bernhardt. I'm an Oaks class of 1983, BA in Theater Arts. And I'm a volunteer on the Silicon Valley Alumni Committee that puts together these events. How many of you are alumni? Any show of hands? Well, we got a lot of the community tonight. And the rest of you, I guess, the community? That's great. We really want to do this to help reach out to the community, not just for alumni. And also, we hope that networking will work between the community and UCSC alumni. Always a good thing. And I want to ask about alumni because any of you could be standing right here next to where I am next time if you want to put together an evening like this with your favorite faculty or researchers or even an alumni social event. We would love you to join us. It's a new group, and we're always looking for fresh blood. I put this together because I like what Gage and Dan do, and that means you can put together about something about what the people you like do. Please see our staff, Sarah and Sam, if you want to know more. I think, unfortunately, right now, they're outside. Oh, there's Sarah way over there, so you can, if you need any information. I wanted to give you some points about UCSC right now. We are now very proud that we're over 50 years old and that we have accomplished a lot in that time. UCSC is now ranked first in research influence around the world. Yes. That has to do with how often UCSC research is cited in other folks' research papers. It's pretty amazing for a little school on the edge of the continent, isn't it? And one of our latest accomplishments is opening the center right in the heart of Silicon Valley. Now you can take classes and come to UCSC events on this side of the hill. And if you haven't had a chance to do yet, we invite you to look around the building before you leave tonight. We're also very happy to celebrate the renaming of College 8 to Rachel Carson College after the late great environmentalist. I'd like to point out that there are still some college naming opportunities. They're still available. Keep it in mind if your startup does really well or your friend's startup does really well. I believe the going rate is about 10 million. It used to be 1 million when I was in college, but you know, things change. But we're serious about this, you know? This is where that money's probably gonna come from. One of our successful alumni or someone they know. And reach out, please. We're also very happy, speaking of money, to announce that last week's Giving Day, we raised over $500,000 in 24 hours for over 100 programs across the campus, including the Natural Reserves programs. And if you missed the opportunity to give last week, we will be very happy to take your donation this week or next. And I know that Gage's and Dan's programs could always use a boost, so if you like what you see tonight, please write a check, donate online, whatever works for you. I think they even take PayPal these days, but you'll have to ask. And the thing is, the reason why we keep asking alumni to give back is because, like, when I was a student, the state of California paid most of the costs of UCs. Now they provide a very small percentage. And if we want to keep this going, someone else has to pay the tab. That's what it comes down to. So we're more like a private university these days, even though we're officially a public one. And now on to our guest speakers tonight. Our first speaker is Dr. Gage Dayton, the director of the UC Santa Cruz Natural Reserves. He holds the Wilbur Webster Jr. Presidential Chair for the UCSC Natural Reserves, serves as the coordinator of field work within the Division of Physical and Biological Sciences, and teaches field-based courses out in the reserves. The natural reserve system encompasses thousands of acres of protected lands and serves as living laboratories and outdoor classrooms. They are indeed the University of California's largest facility. And you can read more about Dr. Gage in our program that you were given on each chair. After Dr. Gage speaks, we will hear from Dr. Daniel Costa, who does his field work at one of those reserves, Año Nuevo. Año Nuevo, an hour north of UCSC, that's where it is. If you haven't had a chance to visit Año Nuevo, I encourage you to go. Seeing the elephant seals in their natural habitat is extraordinary. There's nothing like jumping over a sand dune to get out of the way of a two-ton animal that's moving just because another two-ton animal is trying to move, and neither notices you. Tonight, Dr. Costa will be pulling back the curtain on the secret life of these marine mammals and sharing what he has learned after years of research at Año Nuevo. Dr. Daniel Costa is a distinguished professor of ecology and evolutionary biology at UCSC. He's also a slug. While he did his BA at UCLA, he received his PhD from UC Santa Cruz. He has worked with a broad range of animals, including turtles, penguins, albatross, seals, sea lions, sirenians, which are manatees and dugongs, whales, and dolphins, and has published over 400 scientific papers. Further information about Dr. Costa is also in your brochures. After they both finish, we'll have a question and answer session, followed by the ever-present business card raffle. If you feel you must tweet this event, our hashtag is #UCSCLive. And now, Dr. Gage.
What? I just dropped my... Oh, it's working. Okay, great. Okay. I already broke the microphone. Yeah. I'll let you fix me.
Oh, let me just put it behind you.
Okay. No, I'm sure it's my fault. Sure, no worries. Put it in my pocket without. Okay, great. Okay, thank you. Sorry about that. It's typically how it goes with my life. Great. Well, thank you, Jessica. I appreciate that. And it's fun. I've never been here. So this is the first time both Dan and I have been over to this facility. So it's fun to see it. And it's, I wasn't sure who we'd be talking to today. Looks like there's a mix of alumni and people from the community. So that's exciting, of all ages, too. I like seeing the younger generation here. I put this picture up here for a lot of reasons. But one of the things, I really like this quote: tell me and I forget, teach me and I remember, and involve me and I learn. I think that really hits home on a lot of fronts. And then these pictures are primarily of students that are involved in various field courses that utilize the UC Natural Reserves. For various disciplines. And then these two ladies, or young ladies, are my two daughters that are teenagers now, and that picture was taken 2 months ago. So it encompasses kind of what I'm going to talk about, the importance of the natural reserves, and give you some history of the natural reserves, but then also people doing the work. But then also it's inspiring to me, because these individuals here are out there, they're learning how to be critical thinkers, they're getting engaged in their study that they're passionate about, and that's our future right there. And so it's really inspiring to be at UC Santa Cruz, where we're able to work with these students and help them become the people that are gonna help us in the future. So, real quickly, everything I'm going to be talking about is really a collaboration with multiple individuals: Dan Costa, Don Kroll, Erica Zavaleta, Pete Romundi, and many, many others. And so most of what I'm up here talking about is just summarizing other people's thoughts and my own as well. I'm going to only speak for about, looks like we have a little bit of a chaos there. So that's about how smoothly this talk will go. It's a little first talk. So we have the presentation outline. I'm going to hit on two things. The first one, which you can't see, is the history of the UC Natural Reserve System. How many people are familiar with the University of California Natural Reserve System? Okay, so maybe a third or so. The second thing I'm going to talk about is the laboratories, or these field stations, these reserves, being used to train the next generation of conservation leaders and critical thinkers. And then I'm going to simply hand the baton off to Dan. So we'll just go through this together, kind of somewhat seamless, and then at the end we'll have questions and we'll be happy to interact with you. So my presentation here will be about 15 minutes leading up into Dan. So I think my first goal is to tell you about the University of California Natural Reserve System. And it's a unique entity in the world, really. And it requires me just to tell you a story. And that story starts out in about 1959, late 1950s, early 1960s. There was an individual named Ken Norris, who was down at UCLA at the time, studying this lovely animal, which is a desert iguana. These desert iguanas live down in the Mojave Desert, and this species that he was working on is in the Palm Valley area. These are a neat animal. They're an herbivore. They eat plants. They climb up in bushes, and that's how they make a living. Really incredible animal, neat physiology as well. And Ken was studying these organisms down there. At that same time, there are faculty from the university taking their geology classes out, their ecology classes out, their herpetology, mammalogy classes to these areas to understand the natural systems that were there. So these outside areas where Ken was doing his work were the living laboratories outdoor classrooms for faculty and undergrads in the late 1950s. With all reptiles, they're ectotherms, which means their body temperature is about the same as ambient temperature. So in the winter, they're not moving around that much. In the spring, they come back to life, if you will, and they're moving around. So one spring, Ken got ready to head out and continue his long-term research where he was studying desert iguanas. And his research place looked something similar to this, right? It was just gone. And you can imagine if you've devoted a lot of your time and energy into studying a particular environment, an organism, and all of a sudden it's gone, that's pretty problematic for a lot of reasons. Now, the faculty who were taking their classes out there as well, they had lost opportunity to redo some of these long-term transects that had been done at the turn of the century, and the teaching opportunity was gone. So this was a real problem. A group of faculty from that area, and this is later in life, this is Ken Norris, Bill Mayhew here, and Mildred Mathias, these individuals got together and said, this is problematic. Now remember now, it was the late 1950s, early 60s, and the baby boomers were coming of age. The U.S. was just growing. It was a real vibrant and abundant time for the country, in California specifically. The population was growing. We were sprawling into areas, and things were changing. And not necessarily for the bad, but it's just how it was. So Palm Springs was developing, and these areas were going away, as were other areas. And these individuals thought, well, we need to do something about this. We need to protect landscapes throughout California so that we can use them for long-term research, whatever that's in perpetuity. And whatever the technologies of the day are, the questions of the day, we need to make sure that these places are here so we can study and understand them in going forward. And we can take our classes out and have those hands-on experiences and really train that next generation of, you know, environmental leaders, if you will. So this was kind of, they were thinking this through, and it was in the early 60s. So at that time, our society was very tuned in to the environmental issues. Rachel Carson, as Jessica mentioned, she was getting a lot of information out to the public. We were seeing that not only our impact on the environment, on species themselves, we were having a negative impact, but we were seeing those impacts trickle down back on us. So people were just very aware at that time. Ken went up to the Office of the President for the University of California, UCOP in Oakland at the time. Clark Kerr was the president there. I know that some of you probably knew Clark, or were certainly around when he was president of the University of California. And the story goes that Ken tried to get an appointment with Clark and finally got one after bugging, you know, him for quite some time, and went and said, hey, Clark, we've got an issue. We've got the most diverse state in the country, one of the most diverse regions in the world, really, and we need to protect it so we can study it and we can learn from it. We can take our students out there. And Clark said, yeah, that sounds like a good idea. You know, why not? Kathleen Kerr, Kay Kerr, his wife, was instrumental in saving the Bay and Save the Bay organization right here in the San Francisco Bay Area. So again, the kind of the stars were aligning. Clark Kerr took it to the Regents, and the Regents voted unanimously to create something called the University of California Natural Reserve System. And this was in 1965, the same year that UC Santa Cruz opened its doors. So now fast forward 52 years. The blue dots here are UC campuses, and the red dots are reserves. We have 39 reserves throughout California that are associated with the University of California. It's the largest natural reserve system, university-run natural reserve system in the world. There's nothing like it. It's been around for half a century now. supporting research and education. Over 140,000 acres within the reserve system, and that doesn't include some large agreements with state and federal entities to support research on those lands. So there's nothing like it. And I highlight these two words because when you think about the natural reserves, one of the knee-jerk reactions is, well, God, there's protected lands all over the place. Why do we need, you know, protected lands within the University of California? What does that, you know, that doesn't make any sense. Well, if you think about the national parks, state parks, NGOs, TNC, what have you, POST, they protect those lands to protect them in perpetuity, but for different reasons as well, for public use, aesthetics, what have you. So nowhere else in the core mission of major land owners or conservation holders do they specifically kind of hold up their mission on research and teaching. So that's very different because these are important places where we need to go out and conduct the long-term studies and have available to our students. And as you'll hear from Dan's talk, you know, it takes, sometimes you can learn quite a bit if you do it for 10, 20, or 30 years. So as Clark Kerr was leaving as his tenure as a president of the University of California, you know, one of his last kind of words or kind of reflecting on his impact was he said, "I doubt that I'll do anything more important in my term of office. It was worth preserving some of the great variety. An awful lot of California was just disappearing and disappearing forever." And so that kind of means a lot in the sense of somebody who played a huge role in getting UC Santa Cruz campus going and did a lot in his tenure at UCOP. But looking back, you know, this is something that he was very proud of and held near to him. So today at UC Santa Cruz, for those of you who went to Santa Cruz, you know, probably hung out in North Campus, and the campus itself is 2,000 acres, and we have a campus reserve, which is a living laboratory right outside the classrooms for our students. That's not on this figure because it's actually not a UC reserve. I can talk to you about that more later if you'd like. But our four reserves that are associated with our campus are Año Nuevo Island and the terrestrial side. Dan will be talking about his research out there. We have Big Creek, and Año Nuevo is actually owned by state parks, but we facilitate the research and education on the island. We have Big Creek, which is 5,000 acres down in Big Sur, Younger Lagoon, which is about 100 acres on the western side of campus, and then Fort Ord, which is 600 acres in Marina. So this is kind of our portfolio of reserves that we've built over the last 50 years. Okay, so this comes out a little bit more clearly. That's good. So the history of the natural reserves, I think it's good for anyone interested in the University of California and UC Santa Cruz to understand that story about where the reserves came from and then what they do and why they're important. And I'm going to talk about that now. Dan's going to hit on the research. What I'm going to hit on is more the impact that the reserves have and field-based learning opportunities have on our undergraduate students and for how these experiences are transformative for them and really play an important role in training that next generation of critical thinkers. Regardless of their discipline, if they're in computer sciences, you know, getting folks out and helping them become critical thinkers is something that we think is very important and aware of the environment. But then also importantly, and you know, primarily, kind of changing or training that next generation of conservation and environmental leaders. So, when we think about typical UC or university facilities like this, where there's an opportunity to talk to one another, engage in discussion, what have you, such as a lecture hall, a chemistry lab, a computer lab where you might be designing video games, or if you're in computer engineering, actually creating, you know, microchips, like all the stuff that goes on right here in Silicon Valley. So beyond the lecture halls, there are these other entities or other facilities, if you will, that are critical and more traditional in the university setting for providing those tangible hands-on experiences. Theaters, where if you're going to dance, if you're going to act, you're going to be, you know, out on a stage, right? In the natural sciences, what you typically have is, these are some outdated photos, but you know, very similar to what I did, or the classes that I had when I was going to undergrad for the biology and environmental science labs. You go into a lab and you're looking at a slide under a microscope. You might be dissecting a frog or a cat or kind of some hands-on experience, or you have the opportunity to look at preserved specimens and learn about their taxonomy and their morphology. So these hands-on experiences are really important for the biological, environmental, and physical sciences. But if you think about kind of training people to be field scientists, geologists, botanists, ecologists, what have you, really these are the places that you need to have, and you have to have your students experience these places and learn from screwing up, going out, doing a study, learning how not to do it, how to do it right the next time, right? Going out and catching a snake and counting the scales and thinking about how it feeds and how that physiology may drive the behavior of that organism, or how simply to dive if you're going to be a marine biologist, how to run transects underwater, how to search for fossils, how to sample in aquatic environments. And these facilities, these natural laboratories, these natural reserves, are equally as important, if not more important, than the traditional lecture halls and laboratories that we have on our campuses. And this is something that's really critical. So at UC Santa Cruz, we feel very strongly, and I could be, you could tell me I'm wrong if you're from another campus, and I'm happy to talk about that. And debate that with you, but we are the leader in field-based learning, and we're becoming a leader. As these opportunities go down for hands-on opportunities for students to get engaged in the natural sciences, traditionally, and they're going down across universities, at Santa Cruz are actually going up. We have 4 immersion courses, which are courses where students spend the entire quarter in the field, studying, learning how to do field science, learning how to be a marine biologist, learning how to work and as a geologist, and that's all that they do. And they go out there and they do that. We have dozens of upper division courses that provide multi-day field opportunities for these students, again, to get those hands-on experiences so they can help them have that aha moment to be that catalyst or that spark. And importantly, something that's near and dear to my heart is that we have new field courses for entry-level students. So trying to get freshmen, traditionally or mostly now coming out of very urban areas, never been outside in a natural environment, haven't camped, many of them, but to get them outside into that environment and have them immerse themselves in that environment and learn about the flora and the fauna in that environment, but then also teach them how to do field science. You know, have them work through a scientific process, a study in a day, but those kind of opportunities teach them how to be critical thinkers. So if they're in robotics, psychology, legal studies, what have you, they come out of the class with an appreciation for the environment and a better understanding of what it means to be a critical thinker, which is really important. So we ask ourselves then, do these experiences actually impact students? And I can throw out dozens of pictures of smiling undergrads holding lizards and snakes and doing things, or just coming off of a transect and catching small mammals with their Quaker oats. And I can just show you, you know, dozens and dozens of pictures. I can throw up, you know, this equal number of quotes such as this from a student that took a course I taught. My peers and I have had the opportunities to conduct our own research in which we were able to ask questions and attempt to answer them ourselves. The knowledge and experience I've gained from these reserves are invaluable, and I'm lucky to have attended an institution that encourages experiential learning. So from a faculty member, somebody teaching these classes, you go, oh, I'm doing such a great job, right? You know, and we truly believe that, whether we're right or wrong. You know, obviously it has an impact on us when the students are telling you that you've changed their life through these opportunities. That's a big deal. But they're anecdotes and smiling faces on pictures. And so one of the things we have done recently is we actually started to try and be a little bit more critical on ourselves and quantify this in a more meaningful way to try and get at some of the criteria that might be more important to the students themselves. So if we look at about 400 people that responded to the survey that we took or that we sent out, we asked students if they took field courses, and a field course was defined as having more than, I think, 4 days in the field. So did you take a field course? the students who took field courses and the students that didn't, and whether they got jobs in their field. All right, so this is getting a little bit more objective and kind of hard numbers, right? And what we saw is that there was about a fourfold increase in the people who had taken a field course that ended up in a job in their field. And that seems to kind of give us a little bit more validation on the impact of these courses. And then another question was, well, for students who had took this survey and had graduated at least 3 years prior to the survey, so taking the number of students down, giving them some time to graduate and go on and do things, how many of those students went on to graduate school in a field related to their study? And we found, again, about a fourfold increase in the number of students that actually went to graduate school who had taken these field courses. So we're pretty confident, we're growing more and more confident beyond the anecdotes that these field opportunities, these field courses, are a real important way to have our students succeed and then go on and be successful and be that change and be the movers and shakers in the field that we want them to be. Okay, so that's my quick lead into the natural reserves and talking about field courses. And now we're going to move on to Año Nuevo Reserve, and Dan's going to talk about the secret life of marine mammals. So Dan will come up here. I've got one more slide, and it's kind of an interesting slide that I want to tell a quick story. So this is an elephant seal. This is Ken Norris, who is also, he was a desert herpetologist. I think he was a musician, an artist, a marine biologist, started marine centers. And then Ken was also Dan's PhD advisor. Dan is going to be talking more about his research, obviously, but one of the things that he probably won't hit on is that Dan is now training students that aren't too much older than you guys right there to work on elephant seals. So this was now a graduate student of Dan's who was an undergraduate at UCSC, who TA'd a marine mammal field biology course and is now out working on elephant seals. She's sitting on an elephant seal right here waiting for somebody to come help her. Yeah, so this neat circle of going back to Ken Norris and that desert iguana to where we're going to go now with Dan talking about what he's been learning over the last 30 years is it's a big circle. So help me welcome Dan Costa.
Thanks, Gage. Yeah, it's really good to be here. And as Gage said, I was a student of Ken Norris. Some of you slugs probably remember Ken. He was unique in that he was the only professor of natural history in the UC system. He had a special, had to get a special dispensation to get that title. He certainly earned it. And Gage just said, this was some years ago, you could probably tell, that was one of my first students. That's Ken and one of his students, Greg Silber at the time. But it does sort of carry the, I've now got students of students who have, some of my students now have their own graduate students, so the path continues. Ken was really good at doing a lot of things. As Gage talked about, he did a lot in natural history, but he was really one of these guys that also would come up with interesting ways to study marine animals, and that's something that the talk that I'm going to give you today, as I've had the good fortune of worked with a number of pioneers in this field of marine mammal science, and Ken was one of them as my graduate advisor. This was the silly C6 submersible or something like that when he was at Oceanic Institute in Hawaii. One of Ken's more famous observations was he's the guy that figured out that dolphins use biosonar, and he had to figure out how to blindfold a dolphin, and that was no easy trick. He tried tying things over. But again, this is sort of a lot of the work we do in the field requires an ability to come up with ingenious ways of doing things and how we measure things. And so that's the talk I'm going to give you today. It's going to focus on Año Nuevo Reserve, where it's played an incredibly important role in my research because it's a 30-minute drive north of our campus, and we can try all kinds of things out. We have investigators coming from literally all over the world, from Australia, from France, from Japan. We have a long-term collaboration with some Japanese colleagues, and they come to work with us to try out their instrumentation and these newfangled ways of measuring things on marine mammals. So I'm going to talk about the secret life of marine mammals, and this is how the traditional way that we study marine mammals is we would follow them by boats or planes, and this is what we'd see, and how we're taking it so that we can actually see the world that they live in and how they work, and that is how we've pulled back the curtain. So the outline is going to say, where did we start? It's a Weddell seal in the Antarctic. What have we learned? And then I'm going to use elephant seals as a case study, and this shows the importance of having a core field program at Año Nuevo where we can come back and try new things, new tools, and continue to do that for a long period of time. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the ecology of seals. I'm going to tell you how we're using seals to study the ocean, using seals as oceanographers. I'm going to take a side trip to the Antarctic and show that a lot of these technologies and these things, tools we've developed at Año Nuevo with elephant seals here, we've applied for Weddell seals and southern elephant seals. And then I'm going to come back to Año Nuevo and talk about some work that we've done with collaborators on the physiology and end with some of the stories about some real quick discussions of how these tools and approaches are allowing us to do some conservation. Okay, so where have we started? Well, when back in 1967 is not where I started, but the person who I worked with as a postdoc first created the first time depth record. And I use this 1967, that's when he published the first paper using, I'll show you the time depth record in a minute. But this is what we knew. We knew that gray seals, harp seals, all these animals were caught on fishing gear at a certain depth. And so this is how we knew how deep they were. And I was a graduate student, I remember reading that a sperm whale was the deepest diving animal because it was caught in a transatlantic cable. And I thought, wow, that's how we know how deep these animals dive, because it got entangled in an undersea cable. That was when I got into this field. This is what we knew. And there was a few studies where they used these little capillary tubes where you'd close one end and the pressure would cause the tube to get wetted, and you could see how deep. And there was the bladdernose seal, which is actually what we call the hooded seal, and Weddell seal. So this is when I got into the field. This was the state of the knowledge. We didn't really know a lot. And the guy that I worked with, I said that at that time, this is Jerry Koyman, when he was a graduate student in the early 60s, working in the Antarctic. And the first time, here's the Weddell seal. And he worked on Weddell seals because these animals naturally go to holes in the ice, and you can put things on them and they come back to that hole. And so the first time depth recorder is this device here. And what it really is was a kitchen timer. You know those kitchen timers, you ratchet them and it would go for an hour? Well, that was the mechanical part. He used some smoked glass and then a Bourdon tube, which would scribe out as that thing turned, and it would last for an hour. And so he put that in, somebody built him a pressure case, an underwater housing, and he put that on the back of a Weddell seal. And it was the first time that anybody could measure how deep and how long any seal, any marine mammal, had ever been able to do. And that's Jerry attaching that device very quickly to the back of the seal and recovering it 15, 20 minutes, an hour later. And what he found is he was able to show that the majority of that these animals were diving about 15 to 20 minutes. Most of the dives were kind of short. And he was able to see that there was a diving pattern, lots of shallow dives, and then some rather deep dives. And so this was really the beginning of our field of a lot of the technology we use today. And I have fun with this because, well, I came into the picture a little later than this, but it sort of is a good point to think about where we've come from. In 1966, for some of us, that isn't so long ago. I came into the picture as a postdoc, and this is the state of the instruments then. And Jerry Koyman's lab, they built this device, which was a time depth recorder that used film. And it had film that would be a spool that would run here and take up. And here at the end of that is a light-emitting diode, which would be inside this pressure housing, so it would be airtight and light-proof. And as the animal dove, this arm would swing across, and you would get a record of the time and depth as the animal was going underwater, and it would last 2 weeks. And you can see a picture here of we put this device on an Antarctic fur seal in the early 80s, and this really completely revolutionized the field. There was all these experiments had done on fur seals because they'd come back to their pup that was sitting on the beach. We published a book in 1986 called fur seals, maternal strategies in land and sea, because we had lots of data on fur seals because they were a good system to study. Now, the other interesting thing about this device is when we buy this film from Kodak, from Eastman Kodak, they say, well, you know, there's only one other organization that buys this film. And remember, this is, we wanted really, really thin film so we could put a lot of it on a spool. And they'd say, well, we can't tell you who that other organization is. Years later, I was reading an article about spy satellites, and it was called the Keyhole Satellite, and it turns out that the film we were buying from Kodak was also the film that was used in the spy satellites for exactly the same reason. We wanted to get as much film as we could on a spool so it would last as long as we wanted. And this is what it would look like, and we'd get these records back, and of course, that's the other thing, is you'd have to load this thing in the dark, put the batteries together, make sure that the O-rings didn't get compromised, do your little, you know, make sure the karma's correct, put this thing on the animal, get it back, open it up, develop it in the dark room, and then hope you got something. And if you did, we'd then get this thing, we'd have it copied and called flow xerography, and we'd get it enlarged, and this is what it would look like. And we'd take these records, so this would be at the surface and the animal's diving down, it's at the bottom and then it comes back up, diving down, comes back up, and this would be a dive record. And we would roll these things out in the hallway and start making up stories about, gee, down here it must have been feeding, and over here it must have been swimming, and over here, oh, look at this really deep dive. Then the real work started, because we'd have to hand digitize this. So we would take each one of these points on this big table with a digitizer and enter these data into a computer, and then with our big 16K computer, analyze our records. So that was the picture I showed you earlier. This is 1983. The same species now in 1998, so that's almost 20 years ago. We now have digital electronics that could last months. So everything in this little device here does more than what was done in this film recorder. This is a transmitter, tells us where the animal is. That's the transmitter here. And now we've added a satellite tracking device that tells us not only what the animal's doing, but tells us where anywhere on the planet it is. So that's 1998 technology, and so you can just see how much has changed. And now these devices, this was a whopping 512K of memory, and now, of course, they're gigabytes, and it's a completely different ballgame. This is our sort of standard piece of equipment. It hasn't changed that much, but it's a little time depth recorder that now can measure light levels, salt switch, temperature. The pressure gauge is right there. We get this thing back. We have to recover it. We download it to computer, and we have all these amazing programs that allows us to do the work. And this thing is about that big. And so this will collect data for, well, it collects data at some, like every second or every 10 seconds, whatever we program it to. If we have it set up for every 8 seconds, it'll take a dive record of an elephant seal for a year. So a real change in our ability to understand and study these animals. So now that we have all this technology, you've got to figure out, well, where is an animal that we can work with? Where do we have animals that we can put these devices out? And that's where elephant seals come in. Having an animal that's 30 minutes north of campus and that sits on the beach when you walk right up to it, it doesn't run away. In fact, sometimes they chase you. You can anesthetize them so they don't bite you and they don't walk away. You glue these things onto the animal using 5-minute epoxy. You go to the hardware store and get your 5-minute epoxy. And then it goes to sea for 3 months and comes back. And so it's an amazing system. 90% of the animals come back. And it allows us to really study these animals in detail that is pretty much unequaled. If you think about what we know about marine mammals, elephant seals are one of the best studied marine mammals that are out there. And this is an example. This is a male northern elephant seal. You can see just by the fact that it's big. The other advantage of being big, you can either put a large number of devices on it or big devices because they're crude and you're just testing out a prototype. And because of their size, they don't care and it really doesn't affect them. In this case, this is a satellite tracking device that collects all the information I've just been telling you, but then transmits that information via satellite. So I could be sitting here right now and connect to the internet, find out where that animal is, how deep it's diving, maybe something about the water temperature, the salinity, the chlorophyll, or anything like that. So this technology is really moving along quite amazingly. So again, having a place like Año Nuevo Reserve where these animals routinely go, that's run with a partnership with the California State Parks Department and UC Santa Cruz, University of California system, is an amazing thing. So what did we learn? What did we find out, anything that was unusual? Well, there's a lot of things we learned, and this is one of my favorite slides, because before we started putting these tracking devices on animals, if you picked up a textbook, and this was a textbook a little old now, but published in 1991, this is what we thought the distribution of northern elephant seals were, basically going along the coast of California up to Vancouver Island. And why did we think this? Because that's where we looked for them. That's where we'd fly our planes or drive our boats, and we knew that the animals bred on these islands. Now, what was interesting is a colleague of mine who was doing these aerial surveys, he said, you know, Dan, it's really strange. We count 100,000 elephant seals on these islands, but when we do the aerial surveys, we get 10% of that. We don't know whether we're just not seeing them or whether they're leaving the area. Well, the answer was both. They're leaving the area, so the animals, this is basically when you put tracking devices on them, the animals aren't staying in the coastal zone, they're going out to sea. And when they go out to sea, they're spending 80% of their time, 80 to 90% of their time underwater. So not only were we looking in the wrong place to see them, we were looking at animals that were spending most of their time underwater. So when we actually asked the animals to tell us, by putting tracking devices on them, where do you go, they come back with a pretty amazing story about they're going over most of the North Pacific. And so that was one of the first really amazing things that we didn't quite anticipate, but that's what we, one of our first major discoveries. And this is an animation. Each one of these is a separate elephant seal, and when the track is really long, it means they're moving fast. When the track is short, it means they're holding in one place. So that worm is about a 7-day period of time. These are all the data we have for about a 10-year period. Some of the animals are going down here to Mexico. Others are, the most of these are going to and from Año Nuevo. We put about 10 to 20 tags out each cycle. There's a post-breeding trip. The females come ashore, give birth, then go to sea for 3 months, come back, and then molt, and then go to sea for 8 months. So each one of these is either a short or a long trip. This is a long trip because the animals are out there for a longer period of time. So these are just 1 year after another, looking at what northern elephant seals are doing. And we've been doing this, we first put tags out in 1983, but in 2004 we started putting out tags on a regular basis every year. So we're now starting to look at how these animals, whether they're changing their diving pattern, we're looking at how they vary their pattern as a function of age, relatedness in terms of how that affects them. We have a graduate student that's starting to look at the question of personality. Does an animal that goes up here, does it have a different characteristic than animals that go out this way? So trying to sort of look at what we would otherwise call noise to see if there's some underlying processes. And the only way you can do that is to have a large data set where you've collected information on a lot of individuals over a long period of time. So that's where they go, but what are they doing when they're out there? Well, this is depth, and this is in meters, and so multiply that by 3, so this would be about 1,200 feet, 1,800 feet, 2,400 feet. And you can see that they, during the daytime, so this is daytime and this is nighttime. At daytime, they're diving deeper than they dive at night. This is very indicative of their feeding on vertically migrating prey, prey that moves up and down, except these are prey that's quite deep. And so they're these really deep water, bizarre fishes that you see, lantern fishes, and those really strained looking, odd shaped fishes are what elephant seals are feeding on. And they follow it as it moves up and down through the water column. The other thing to look at this is a record that goes for 4 days. When does the animal sleep? It doesn't stop throughout that whole record. If I blow this up, and I think there'll be a few images, you'll see these animals apparently never sleep. Or if they sleep, they sleep during the dives. And we've studied animals in the laboratory in terms of sleep. What we haven't done is figured out if they sleep when they're at sea. The deepest dive is some 1,735 meters, which is well over a mile. On average, they're diving 516 meters, which is about 1,600 feet. that's really, really deep. And to them, that's home. This is where an elephant seal spends most of its time. 80% of its time is spent underwater, with very little time spent at the surface.
How long do they hold their breath?
Right here, that's a good question. They typically hold their breath for about 20 to 25 minutes, with about a 2 to 3 minute surface interval. And we can figure out, we have a pretty good idea of how they do that based on the physiology, how much oxygen they can store. They have an internal scuba tank. They have a large, 20% of their body is blood. They have muscle myoglobin, so they store lots of oxygen in their blood. And the 20-minute dives, we know how they can do that. That fits our understanding. What doesn't fit is this is a record of a single individual where it made an hour and 9 minute dive, 2 minute surface interval. An hour dive, 2 minute surface interval. 51 minute dive, 2 minute surface interval. An hour and 43 minute dive, 2 minute surface interval. I always say, these animals haven't read our papers. They're not supposed to do this. And this is one of the, this is that hour and 43 minute dive. These are very rare. This is the longest, deepest one we've ever seen. We do occasionally get these records, and our speculation is it's probably avoiding a predator, but it's a guess. And it kind of makes sense. If you add up how much time over this, what is that, 6-8 hour period of time, the animal spends like 10 minutes at the surface over an 8 hour period of time. So what better way to avoid a predator by staying down here where it's deep and it's going to be harder for you to find you, whereas at the surface you're going to be a sitting duck. That's what we think, but we really don't know. Now, as we start looking at these records, we start to see pattern emerges. And my favorite story is one of our Japanese colleagues said, well, Dan and Bernie, what are these funny dives? We see these dives, which we call foraging dives. And you can imagine, again, this is storytelling. You look at these dives and you go, okay, the animal's going up and down. That makes sense. It's chasing prey through the water column. And so this makes pretty good sense. And I'll show you in a minute that we actually now know that these are feeding dives. But this is what we kind of speculated. And then we get these dives where the animal dives down, stops, and sinks, then goes up. Dives down, sinks, goes up again. And we didn't know what they were. Our Japanese colleague says, what do you think these are? And what was interesting is that these dives were the same duration as these dives. And if you think about, well, what's going on here? And our best guess is these are processing dives. And we mean, this is when the animal's digesting its food. What after a big meal, what do? You sit back and relax and don't do anything. All the blood rushes to your stomach. You're not, after a big meal, you're not going to go out and run a marathon. So what we think is happening is these animals have been feeding, putting away all kinds of food. They're not spending any time at the surface. So they're not spending time at the surface breathing oxygen. So these dives, instead of putting the blood to the muscles, they're putting blood to the GI tract to digest the food that they've been acquiring over these previous dives. Now, there's another neat thing about these so-called processing dives. We call them sea dives. This is a single dive up close. You see the animal goes down, and then it sinks. And I'll show you in a minute that we actually know that they are sinking because we put accelerometers and swim velocity tags on them. So we know they're drifting. Well, something drifts through the water as a function of its buoyancy, and its buoyancy is determined by how fat it is. So an animal like this is a rather skinny elephant seal. If you look at this record over time, a fat elephant seal actually floats. In fact, we get records where the animals go down to depth, stop swimming, and then float up instead of sinking down. And so what this says is that we have a way of, over this 3 to 6 to 8 month trip to sea, we can see how the condition, how fat the animal is getting over the period of time that it's feeding. And what's cool about, and so this is showing us that it's a drift dive, and a little animation here. This, you can see the animal goes down and it's sort of falling like a leaf, sort of this little, it's just sinking. And so this is where it's drifting down, just sinking. This is where it swims down to that point, goes to depth, then turns around and swims back up. So again, it shows that they're drifting. And what we've done is looked at these periods of where the animals are drifting. We've measured where they're getting fatter. And we can map that over. Here's all the tracks of our elephant seals. And now we can map out over the North Pacific, the areas where the animals are doing these drift dives, which mean these are places where they're feeding a lot because that's where they're doing these drift dives, and where they're also transiting very slowly. So it's a combination of these are where there's lots of drift dives. This is where the animals are getting really fat. It also is the areas where the animals aren't moving very fast, which makes sense that that'd be a place where there's lots of food. So we can map out where in the North Pacific elephant seals are getting their food and how well they're doing. Now, I told you we were going to come up with a way of actually measuring this for sure. And what our, again, our Japanese colleagues have a thing they call a kamikami logger, which is a basically a, it means, I can't remember what it means. It means something to do with jaw opening and closing. But it's a little device that whenever the animal opens and closes its mouth, it logs that position, logs that activity. And we've calibrated these in the lab by feeding animals fish and then calibrating what that acceleration looks like. And so we can say whenever the animal does a particular movement, that's a feeding event. And so you can look at these dive records now, and each one of these red dots are a feeding event. And this is a 3D image where you can see the feeding events, and you see these periods where there's no feeding. Those are those sea dives. Again, those dives where the animals are drifting. And so now we can see that the animals, in fact, are feeding in the bottom of these dives where we thought they were. And of course, the animals had to prove us wrong that occasionally they do something different. But again, that's not surprising that every now and then they'll find something on the way up or the way down and have a snack. So again, I keep coming back to our Japanese colleagues because they, I tell my lab if Yasuo Naito gives us a call, we'll just, whatever he wants to do, we'll do it. Because from the beginning, in the early 80s, he came up with a time depth recorder that lasted 3 months instead of 2 weeks. And then he came up with a little jaw recorder. And so the latest thing is they've come up with little cameras that we can put on the elephant seal. And this is a film from an elephant seal. Boom, that was a fish. So we've now been putting these cameras on elephant seals, and you can see that fish. Let's see if I can. So we're now being able to really see that these animals are in fact eating. Yeah.
Are they the eyelashes?
Yeah. Oh, these are the whiskers. And of course, then the other thing is when you start working with these data, you want to visualize them. You want to figure out how to put this in the context that you can understand in an insightful way. And this is a figure that, a lot of these figures actually, Patrick Robinson, who is our reserve manager at Ani Nuevo, has put together. And the other story, which I'm not going to spend a lot of time on here, is not just the technology, but the ability to take that technology and the data and put it into a format that helps us understand it, helps us look into what the animals are doing. And this is a track of a female elephant seal. This is a seamount out in the North Pacific. You can see that she's swimming along. She goes and she spends lots of time on this seamount, then swims along, goes up to another seamount, and then swims off. We tracked the same female the next year, and she did the same track, but then didn't spend any time at the seamount. And the best thing we can figure is either she cleaned it out the year before or something else happened to that seamount, so there was no food there the following year. Now we talk about these animals that do trip after trip. And again, one of the things that when you have a place like Ani Nuevo where you can go back year after year, you start to be able to find the same individuals recurring from one year to the next. And these are tracks of one individual over three different years, and you can see this female has a really high site fidelity, that she goes to the same place year after year, as does this female. And this female is a little bit different. She kind of has a similar pattern, but not really. So the green is what she did one year, the blue is what she did another year, and the red is what she did in a different year. And one of the things we're starting to do is ask the questions about what drives these patterns of fidelity. What is the, quote, personality of an animal like this compared to the personality of an animal like this? Is this animal risk-averse? Is this animal risk-tolerant? And what are the implications of that? And so my graduate student, Rachel Holzer, is coming up with ways of seeing how animals react to novel stimuli, we have over 500 records of elephant seals, and now we can go back and ask for animals that we've already worked with. We can study them on the beach, see how they react to novel stimuli. The novel stimuli, she drives a little car up and plays sounds at the animals and see whether they ignore it, whether they attack the sound. But to just start to take a very simple test of how do these animals respond to something that they haven't seen before. This is one of my favorite stories. This is a track of a female in 1995, and 11 years later, that same female as a 17-year-old. The reason, other than the fact that it's a pretty amazing record, this is one of those amazing serendipities. We tracked this female in 1995. We only tagged maybe 20 animals back then. We didn't have that much money to pay for the tags. In 2006, I had a graduate student that was trying to put tags out on six-year-olds. He read the tag wrong on this individual. It was a 17-year-old. We would normally not put a tag out on a 17-year-old. That's getting kind of old. So he read the tag wrong. He thought it was a six-year-old. He went ahead and put the instrumentation on it. When he got back to the lab, he found out it was a 17-year-old female, but even more importantly, it was a female we had tagged 11 years earlier. Completely by accident, we got a track of a female when she was a six-year-old and a female as a 17-year-old. And it's a pretty amazing track that tells you something about how some of these females really get into doing the same thing year after year. Now, again, as we've studied these animals and you continue to tag animals on the beach, by not even paying attention to what we're doing, because there's about 2,000 individuals, we sort of said, hey, you know, we've been doing this for a little over 12 years, and females start breeding at about 3 or 4, most prime ages about 6. We started going through our records and identifying, because we go and keep track of who gives birth to who, whose mother is who. And what we've been able to do is we've now got about 20 tracks of mothers and daughters. And this is the mom as a six-year-old, and this is her daughter as a six-year-old. And so we have about 20 of these tracks, and we're now just starting to target females where we have who their mother was, and we say, oh, female 9276, we tracked her mother 6 years ago. Let's go ahead and make sure we put a tag out. And so we're starting to ask the question about, is there an instinctive component? Is there a genetic component? And I say genetic because mom leaves, the pup's left on the beach by itself. The pup has to figure out how to be an elephant seal on its own. Mom is long gone by the time the pup makes its first trip to sea. So this is something where it's ongoing, and it's an interesting study. I'll come back and tell you what we find out in a little while once we start to get a few more of those records. So that's kind of an overview of some of the things we've learned about elephant seals proper. I'm now going to switch and tell you about how we're using elephant seals to study their environment, how we use elephant seals as oceanographers. Now, quite simply, the North Pacific works this way. There's currents that flow across and creates the California Current, and there's a current that flows north of us and then creates the subarctic gyre of Alaska, so there's Alaska Coastal Current. And there's a big boundary between these two sort of gyres. And this region here is what we think of as the Serengeti, the blue Serengeti. Well, this is where the grasslands of the ocean, it's called, the term here is the transition chlorophyll front. That's where all the primary production is. So this is a very important region of the North Pacific. And our question is, well, where do elephant seals fit into this story? And what can they tell us about the oceanography, the physics, the chemistry of this region? Well, I just showed you that picture, and here's that boundary, and this is some 300 elephant seals over a 7-year period of time, and they really like that boundary, that physical feature, and we all think about, well, what's a front? In the ocean, a front, this is a front. Well, we go to the Weather Channel, and we hear about a cold front moving in, or we hear about a warm front moving in. We hear high-pressure zones, low-pressure zones. It's the same thing in the ocean. This would be like like a low pressure zone, this would be a high pressure zone, and that front is where those two water masses, we talk about air masses for weather, in the ocean those water masses meet. And this is what the region of the North Pacific that elephant seals like. So this heat map is where most of our animals are concentrating. Now if you take a line through this picture like that, and we had at least one elephant seal that did that, and you look at what her temperature, so now we have, remember I had a temperature probe on the animal. this is going from from 40 degrees from here up through here, so this is going across that feature. You can see this is cold water here, this is warm water, so here's that warm subtropical water, that colder North Pacific subarctic water, and here's that hydrographic feature, that frontal structure, and that's where most of the elephant seals are located. We have the same thing here in the winter, the summer to winter. This is where the elephant seals are, and here's that warm water, cold water, and there's that frontal feature. So this is where the elephant seals like to be. That's what we know. Now the question of what's out there, and that's the next thing we're working on. The getting out here to measure what's out there is a challenge, and other than getting pictures from elephant seals, going out there by ship is still a little bit. We've done some work again with our Japanese colleagues, but something we still hope to do some more with. Well, yeah, and there are Argo buoys, and one of the things that we can do is to use the Argo buoys, but one of the nice things about elephant seals is they're sort of their own Argo buoy, because they're recording temperature profiles in relationship to how they're using the ocean. And so where you might say, oh, there's an Argo buoy here, here, and here, but you really want to know is what's happening here in fine scale, and the animals give us that information at the scale in which they operate. This is an example of what we call an eddy. And so that's a track of an elephant seal. This is an eddy, which would be like a cyclone or a hurricane on land. These are sort of gyrating parts of the water mass. Remember that current's moving this way. This is the Alaska current. These eddies sort of spin off from the interaction of the water with the land. And the result is these features that some elephant seals really like those and spend a lot of time. This one female did most of her feeding in these structures. If we take that track, so that's the picture you saw just earlier, and you take the temperature profile, so this is depth and going across that area here, you can see warm water, this is cold water, and this is that eddy. You can see that the water in that eddy is being forced down, so that warmer surface water is being forced down into the ocean. And these are very important in what we call ventilating the ocean, how you get the surface layer mixed to the deep ocean. We worry about CO2 and whether the ocean takes our CO2. So understanding the dynamics of these structures is really important in understanding the ocean as a system in and of itself. And elephant seals can help us understand that, because getting measurements that span across these eddies would be very difficult unless you went there by ship, and going out there by ship is expensive. Now, many of you probably heard about the blob we've had off the coast here recently, and this is a large body of water that here's our California coast. This is satellite surface temperatures. These are tracks of elephant seals. And so our elephant seals really liked, well, this is totally by chance, the blob is right smack in the middle of the elephant seal migration pattern. And the Argo buoys, I took that slide out, the Argo buoys sort of are everywhere but the blob. And so we have tracks of elephant seals that have gone through this feature. And again, my student Rachel Holzer is taking these data and putting, this is a track of an individual animal, this one here, this dark one, and right through here you can see she moves around and then says, I'm out of here. And this is that track where you're looking, here's colder water, warmer water surface, she's moving along, this is in the middle of that blob, this is where she says, I'm out of here, and goes to the north. So this animal's giving us temperature profiles of this feature, because when I show you this, this shows us the surface extent, but what you really need to know to understand these features is not just the surface profile, but how deep that feature goes into the ocean. And you can see right here, it goes rather deep. This is another example where that blob, that feature, that same track. And now we're asking, well, how does the animal's behavior change? How does the animal deal with this blob? And each one of these dots is a depth of a dive. So we're looking at the temperature profile and then asking, how does the animal's diving behavior change? And you can see that here, where the blob is, the animal's not diving anywhere near as much as it does outside of the blob. This is the daylight, nighttime diving pattern. And so you see that the animal's in this region are all sort of squished down, that their diving is consistently deeper. So the animals are diving in a more constrained region during that blob. They're going deeper during the day, shallower at night. They're going deeper at night when they have that warm water. And we suspect that that's because their prey base is also migrating. Again, this is some figures that Rachel just put together just last week. So that's sort of using animals as oceanographers. And I'm going to take you to the Antarctic to ask some questions about using these same technologies that we've developed working on elephant seals at Año Nuevo and working with predominantly southern elephant seals, but also this is a Weddell seal in the Antarctic working with one of those satellite tracking devices. What are we learning about the Antarctic? Well, why would we even want to go to the Antarctic other than it's a pretty cool place? The Antarctic Peninsula, where I'm going to show you data, is one of the most rapidly warming places on the planet. So here's the Antarctic Peninsula. This is showing rapidly warming the parts of Canada and Siberia. These are the three regions of the world which are undergoing the most rapid climate change. So we've been studying this area here. We use these tags to sort of first ask the question, well, how do these different species, we have a southern elephant seal, crab-eater seal, and a Weddell seal, how do they partition the habitat? And so I've been showing you all about northern elephant seals. Well, now these yellow tracks are southern elephant seals. And you can see that the southern elephant seals are sort of going offshore. This sort of yellowish, greenish color is land. This is continental shelf. This is deep ocean. So this is that Antarctic Peninsula. You see the elephant seals are going off to shore, going on the outer reaches of the continental shelf. These green colors are Weddell seals, which are staying inside in the fjords, and the red are crab-eater seals, which are staying in the fjords and sort of in the inner continental shelf of the peninsula. So right off the bat, we see three very different patterns in how these animals are utilizing this region. So the question becomes, well, how reliant are they on ice? How reliant are they on the changing habitats? This shows that same picture. Elephant seals are diving deeper and longer. Weddell seals dive deep, dive long, but not as deep. And crab-eater seals are shallowest and the shortest diver. But again, you can see this pattern that the elephant seals are further offshore. The crab-eater seals are sort of on the continental shelf. And the Weddell seals are deep in those fjords. This is not working on this computer. This was an animation that showed that elephant seals didn't care about the ice and that crab-eater seals were confined to the ice and that they needed that ice as part of their habitat. And that's important because we have models that we can look at how the ice conditions are changing. And so this is current conditions. This is where the ice is in the wintertime in the Antarctic Peninsula. And here's when we run the models and say the wind speed's going to increase by 50%, which is what the climate change models tell us it will be. You can see that the amount of ice in this region is dramatically reduced. So why should we care? Well, ice is an important habitat, sea ice, for this critter, the Antarctic krill. Antarctic krill rely on ice as part of its habitat, and this critter, the crab-eater seal, feeds predominantly on Antarctic krill. And they have this very unusual tooth formation, which is sort of like a sieve that allows them to feed on this krill. So the image that I couldn't show you that was an animation shows that these guys need the ice to haul out on, to pup on. They also need the ice because that's what their predominant prey item, krill, relies on in terms of its life history. So if we say, okay, what do crab-eater seals who rely on ice for substrate rely on ice for the krill? Weddell seals rely on ice for the substrate. They need ice. Their population's going to decline. Things like elephant seals, which don't care about the ice, and in fact, as the ice goes further south, it makes more habitat for them. Their population could increase, but we don't know how the food base is going to change. So this is one of the things I say a lot about climate change, is there's going to be winners and losers. Some things will be able to deal with the climate change, other things won't. And the question is, how much do we care about the things that lose and the things that are going to win? They may or may not be things we care about. Now, this is another one of those fun stories about how we've been able to use these animals to do things we hadn't thought about. And some of you may have, we all now hear about all the ice, there's a big thing in the news now about ice sheets breaking up in the Antarctic. There's this ice, at this ice sheet, the Larsen B ice shelf is one where in the news now there's a big crack in it and it's starting to come off. Well, in 2008, there was this ice shelf. It's called the Wilkins ice shelf. And you can see here that this is what the picture looked like in the beginning of March. And then the ice shelf started to break up and then it completely collapsed. And so there was a lot of interest in this. And it just so happened that we had been putting tags out on elephant seals up here in Livingston Island. And these animals were moving back and forth this area right here, which is the Wilkins ice shelf, at about the time this ice shelf broke apart. Now, these tags were carrying both salinity and temperature transducers on it. And I sort of went, hey, I don't know what to do with the kind of data that you would study an ice shelf. I just know how to study seals. But I put out the word to anybody, any of my physical oceanographic colleagues, I said, hey, you guys, we've got some really cool data. We've got data from animals swimming around when this ice shelf came out. This guy, Laurie Padman, up in Oregon, said, hey, why don't you send me those data? So we sent him the data. And the first thing he did is he started looking through the dive records and he said, hey, these animals are diving deeper than the bottom. And I said, yeah, I know, they're not mole seals. And he said, yeah, but we can map the Antarctic continent that way. This area is, some of the depth records here come back from ships that went there 100 years ago. There aren't a lot of ships going to this region of the world taking depth soundings. So what we have is these colors are positions of elephant seals where we know the depth of their deepest dive, and their deepest dive was deeper than the known bottom. And so we were able to improve the quality of the bathymetry of this region by using the elephant seal diving pattern. Now, what was neat about that is one of the things that the elephant seals told us is that there were these deep troughs or canyons in the continental shelf that we didn't know about before. And one of them is a trough that went up to this Wilkins ice shelf. And if you look at this deep trough, and this is now a temperature profile, so this is warmer water that's measured by the seal. And you can see that this warmer water sort of extends onto the continental shelf. The Antarctic current moves along this way, and these canyons allow the deeper, warmer water to come up onto the continental shelf and go underneath the Wilkins ice shelf. And if you see, there's this blue, cooler water. So you can see this current where the warmer, deeper water comes up on the continental shelf, warms the ice shelf, and then comes out cooler. When they did the first studies of the atmospheric heat budget of the Wilkins ice shelf, they couldn't make the budget meet. The ice shelf broke up sooner than it should have based on just atmospheric heat. When you put into it what they call the basal melt, this heat coming from the ocean, it all made sense. And so our elephant seals gave us information that allowed us to answer the question, why did the Wilkins ice shelf fall apart as soon as it did? Something that I would never have gone into this business, I'm going to study ice shelves. But it's actually because of the difficulty of putting instrumentation on buoys and other things because of the presence of ice, elephant seals have become one of the primary oceanographic instruments that a lot of the Antarctic physical oceanographers are using. In fact, we now have a program called MEOP, Marine Mammals as Explorers of the Ocean Pole to Pole. These are now tracks of elephant seals and Weddell seals and whatever we can get our hands on. All of these animals are carrying oceanographic quality instrumentation and are being used by our physical and chemical oceanographers to study the Antarctic continent. And this shows a figure of, here's all the traditional data that's collected without seals. This is when you take the traditional data and add seals to it. And you can see these regions here are completely filled in by the presence, by the acquisition of elephant seal collected temperature profiles. So not only seals are interesting in their own right, they're giving us a lot of information on the environment that they live on as well. Okay, so I told you I was going to talk about physiology, and I'm going to close with some other work that we've been doing on physiology. And this is work predominantly with a guy named Paul Panganis, another slug. Paul was a graduate student just ahead of me in the same lab. He went off and became an MD in anesthesiology. So he's now working at Scripps. And he's been developing devices that we can implant blood oxygen electrodes, heart rate electrodes. Under all of this is an elephant seal. These are two of my graduate students. Gina McDonald is now a faculty at Moss Landing Marine Labs. And what we're able to do is measure things like, here's the diving pattern of the elephant seal, and now using just those simple polar heart rate recorders that you go work out with, we'd waterproof them, put them on a seal. And you can see that elephant seals, when they're at the surface, about 100, 120 beats per minute. When it dives, drops about 40, 50 beats per minute. Something interesting happened here, and its heart rate dropped to about 5 beats per minute. So what's interesting is it's a thing called bradycardia. If you hold your breath, and especially if you put your face in cold water and hold your breath, we will also have a drop in heart rate like this. But seals and marine mammals in general are really good at it, and that's what this figure shows. Now, the other thing that's really they're really good at is this is those data that Paul Panganis, here's the diving pattern here, so this is the dive of the animal. And what we have here is blood oxygen. So this is the oxygen content of the blood of a seal diving at sea, and this is where a humid would black out. And that's just at the beginning of the dive, the threshold for humans blacking out is reached, and the final oxygen content is about 3 millimeters of mercury, 3 torr, which is almost, there's almost no oxygen left in the animal's blood. And so we're able to start to look at how these animals dive, how they can do it physiologically, and using this amazing instrumentation that not only is starting to tell us where they're going, but how they're doing it. And this is just another one of those kind of cool figures that shows this is where the animal has lots of oxygen in its blood, and then it starts to go away, and then as it comes up, it gets really, the oxygen goes away. The reason that the oxygen gets higher during the dive is this is the oxygen, as the lung collapses, the oxygen content goes up a little bit because of the pressure that causes the oxygen to be slightly more enriched, and then it goes away. And so we can see, as the animal is swimming, we can look at the pattern of how the animal uses its oxygen over that period of time. One final caveat is, for many of us, it started as curiosity. How do we understand these animals? How do we figure out where they go and what they do? Increasingly, how do we conserve them? How do we make sure that the next generation can see these animals? And so that gets into conservation. And I'll just give you two real quick stories of how diving recorders are giving us insights into conservation. These are pictures of Australian sea lions that are being caught in a shark gill fishery in off South Australia. We had been doing work where we were tracking these animals. Female Australian sea lions, Adelaide is up here somewhere. Adelaide's right there. This is Kangaroo Island. If you're ever in Australia, Kangaroo Island is an amazing place to go. The point here is that these animals dive on the continental shelf in a proximity to the colony. So the colony's there. This is where the animals are feeding. We looked at where the gillnet fishery was, and we could predict where the overlap was. And we know that the animals don't feed deeper than 100 meters. And so what we did is proposed that if you had a closure around these colonies, that you could fish anywhere below 100 meters, the animals would be safe. And in fact, that's what the Australian government did, is they closed the gillnet fishery for sharks around the colonies in such a way that it protects the females. And it was the females that were predominantly getting killed in this gillnet fishery. So that's one example. Another example is New Zealand sea lions. And here, the story's a little more complicated. Here we have two different kinds of foraging patterns. One where animals are feeding on the bottom, fish and things, and another group of animals that feed on mesopelagically on squids. And these animals that feed mesopelagically, feeding on squids, is right in the middle of a New Zealand squid fishery. And so for these individuals that are feeding in this part of the ocean, there's a significant conflict. For these individuals that are feeding on the benthos, not so much of a conflict. I could go into a lot more of a story, but I could tell you that this is a much harder foraging behavior than this. And so the best habitat for the New Zealand sea lion is where there's the greatest conflict with the squid fishery. So this is a story which is still evolving. The Australian government was very good about protecting the Australian sea lion The New Zealand government has been trying to do their job with the squid fishery, but it's still a work in progress. So I hope I've given you some insights into what we've learned, where we came from, how these different approaches and different tools are really sort of, I think, opening up what these animals are doing in a realm that's otherwise very difficult for us to study. Thank you very much.